Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawne. And today we're getting enthusiastic about fricatives. But first, we have new merch. We now have Kiki Booba merch available in the Lingthusiasm store.
So this is from a classic psycholinguistics experiment where you show people two shapes, a spiky one and a rounded one, and you ask them which one is called Booba and which one is called Kiki, so you can now conduct this experiment with your friends and acquaintances using your scarf, mug, notebook, etc.
You may recall Booba and Kiki from our episode What Words Sound Spiky Across Languages, which was a chat that I had with psycholinguist Susie Stiles. If you haven't listened to that yet, there is a treat awaiting you.
We've also expanded the range of items that you can get with our IPA esoteric symbols designs. And also we have an exciting new merch range that we're going to tell you about towards the end of this episode because it'll make more sense then.
Mm-hmm, indeed.
So tantalizing.
If you have listened to our episode about Kiki and Booba and all of our other main episodes and would like to listen to bonus episodes, our most recent Patreon episode was about speaking under the influence. There's that and 52 other bonus episodes awaiting you.
And you can see links to our merch, both new and old, from lingthusiasm.com/merch or any of our social media.
I have a list of words, Gretchen. Are you ready to figure out what they all have in common?
I am so ready.
I can promise you it's nothing semantic.
So, okay. Good start.
You could try and start a story with these. Fan, vote, thing, than, seep, shin, zhuzh, and hand. And is not one of the words.
I mean, now that you've issued this challenge, I feel like I do need to construct a story with them. But I'm gonna play along and say I think what these have in common is that they all start with a particular type of sound.
They do indeed. They all are produced with some kind of friction in your mouth where you can feel there's like turbulence in between two parts of your mouth. They're all different parts.
So when I make a f or zzz or h, I'm making a sort of some degree of constriction. I'm pushing some parts together a little bit, and then I'm sort of forcing the air through, and that turbulence, that gush of air, is making this very sort of frictiony sound.
And that flow of air is very different to a sound where a part of your mouth is fully closed, like p or t. These sounds like vote or shin can really go on as long as you have air in your lungs.
But at the same time, it's your mouth also isn't fully open, like where you're doing a full vowel. You're definitely creating a point of constriction in your mouth. It's just that it's not a completely closed off bit of air.
And that constriction creates friction. And that's why these types of sounds are known as fricatives. And one of the best ways that I have of remembering fricatives is the phrase, fricative parties don't stop. Because you get that continuing rush of air.
Yes, you could do the continuing rush of air. And also, because this is even funnier if you know that these sounds like P and D, where the air does stop in your mouth, are technically known as stops. And so the fricative party is not a stop. I think this was one of the first linguistics memes I encountered was about the fricative party doesn't stop.
I've definitely seen it on posters and t-shirts. It's a good one. And it's good if you use it to remember this type of sound. We're going to take a tour of some of our favorite fricatives in this episode.
With the caveat that the fricatives row of the International Phonetic Alphabet is the most populated row of sounds. So there are a lot of fricatives. We're not going to get to all of them. This is sort of an express train tour that doesn't stop at all of the stops. Oh, wow. No, I can't say the word stop anymore.
This metaphor has failed very early on. We will be visiting some of our favorite fricatives. If you have other fricative stories or facts that you want to share, please feel free to talk about them in the Patreon Discord, or you can tag Lingthusiasm on social media and we might be able to share them.
Yeah, there are more fricative stories that we have not told. Please continue the fricative party. May it never stop.
The best place to start is probably with the f in fricative, which is a fricative itself.
Yeah, this is my favorite type of linguistic terminology. Not all linguistic terminology is as convenient as this, but fricative begins with a fricative. It's very convenient and easy to remember that way.
I feel like we've done some other self-defining terminology episodes. Oh, we've done one on rotics, which starts with a r.
That's true. Unfortunately, we've done an episode on schwa, which does not have a schwa in it, but used to. There used to be schwa. So yeah, it doesn't always happen, but occasionally it's very nice.
It's very satisfying when it does. The other fricative in fricative is...
There's a second one.
Yeah. F and V are made at exactly the same place in the mouth, usually with your lower lip touching your upper teeth. The difference between them is that the f sound doesn't involve any vibration, whereas if you make the v sound, nothing else has changed, but you'll feel that buzzing of vibration in your vocal cords while you make it.
Yeah, so I think this is the point where we start saying, all right, you know, it's a rite of passage for every budding linguist to be going around saying sounds with your hand on your throat, thinking about where are my lips and tongue doing right now? Because you're so used to doing this automatically, you don't think about it overtly anymore. So if you find yourself doing that in this episode, rest assured you are entirely normal. And if people are giving you strange looks, that is their problem.
Special shout out to people who are commuting on public transport while listening to this episode.
I'm so sorry. You know, make sure if you're trying to do this under your breath, you're not going to get this vocal cord distinction if you're whispering, because that's what whispering is it's not using your vocal cords. So you will need to say it a little bit louder if you want to be able to feel that difference. Brought to you by me as a teenager not knowing this and having a real difficult
learning
time.
Learning the hard way.
Yep.
So English has a f in a word like fine and v in a word like vine. But English hasn't always had a V of its own.
Yeah, so you get these pairs in English of words like knife, knives, wolf, wolves, leaf, leaves, where suddenly you make it plural and then the F changes to V. And this was this sort of like spelling thing that I had to learn as a kid in school.
Mm-hmm.
But there are historical reasons for that.
When a sound that doesn't have vibration sits between two vowels, which are made with those vibrations, the efficient thing to do is just keep the vibrations happening throughout that little string of sounds. So instead of leafs.
The complicated thing here, right, is that when you write wolf wolves or leaf leaves, you change the F to a V and add ES, which is the thing I learned in school. But, like, You do that because at one point, first of all, the E was pronounced. So it was, like, leaf, leaf, leafes, or something like that. And then that E that was pronounced changed the F to a V. And then we stopped pronouncing the E, the silent E, but we kept the relic of it in the different pronunciation of the F as V.
And this is not unique to English. This kind of sound change happens across languages quite often. And that happened in the middle of words. But then the other thing that happened to English was French turned up. And French does have that V sound at the start of words as well. And so if an English word has a V at the beginning, there's a very high chance that that was borrowed from French.
Yeah, and now English has words like vine and very and things like that that got borrowed from languages like French and Latin that did have a V sound. So now V feels like it has this full status in English as like a sound you can use in a lot of different contexts. But it wasn't always like that. And we have a few relics of that left in the writing system, you know, also with pairs like give and gift, where like F and V sometimes make a pair. So F and V are made with the lip and one part of the teeth. But you can actually make a fricative with both of the lips, like p and v. If you sort of try to make p and but just give them a little bit more space, you can make p and v.
Mm-hmm.
And this isn't found in English, really, but it is found in other languages. They're found in Spanish to some degree. But these sounds sound quite a lot like either b or v, or either p or f. So sometimes the languages just use them as variants of sounds they already have, and they don't make them sort of stars of, like, we're going to make this sound carry a lot of meaning in this language. So they're found, but they're often found as sort of, I don't know, I want to say like werewolves. Like, they only show up in certain contexts when there's a full moon.
A little bit like our old English V, which only popped up in the middle of words towards the end of them and wasn't everywhere all the time.
Yeah, exactly. So sometimes you have sounds that can kind of show up in a language, but not be particularly important for making entirely new words.
If we move our attention further back in the mouth rather than further forward, we end up at the sounds, because there are more than one in English, th and the.
So these are sounds like in bath and bathe, or in either and ether.
Oh, that's a good pair.
Yeah. Or in wreath and wreathe.
We don't often pay attention to them because they get written in English with the same TH combination, but they're actually two different sounds. One involves vibration of the vocal cords and one doesn't.
Yeah, and this like vocal cord vibration theme just keeps coming up because, especially in English with the history of fricatives, bath and bathe, wreath and wreathe, breath and breathe, they were also sort of pairs where one of them had a vowel after them. And so that version of the TH, which there are two TH sounds, was between two vowels, just like the F was between two vowels and became V, and the TH in between two vowels became THE, which is also, you know, getting that, here's your vocal cords vibrating again because you're between two vowels. So this is a sort of thing that happens specifically in English fricatives, although it's not uncommon across other languages as well.
I sometimes wonder if we would pay more attention to the difference between the and the if we had different symbols for them. And English used to, yeah, before the printing press ruined everything.
Yeah, I mean, like, Icelandic still has a symbol for the sound, which is this sort of circle with a line and a cross above it, which is called ev.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is available in other languages. It's just not a thing that printing presses from continental Europe had, because, like, French doesn't have this sound, like, Dutch doesn't have this sound. That's where they were importing printing presses from. They didn't have a symbol for this sound, and so they're like, oh, I guess we could just do something else with it instead.
Whereas the English runic system used to have thorn, which looked like a little thorn on a branch, and, I mean, meant thorn as well, but was used for this sound. And it was an attempt to use Y to represent that really lazily in old printing, which is why the old teashoppe looks like ye old teashoppe.
Yeah, it was actually them just trying to pronounce the old teashoppe. And use a different letter for it. So if you ever see that on a rent fair sign, you know what it is from now. But the one that they ended up sticking with was using a TH for both of them. And there really would have been an argument to use like TH and DH for them. It's just that the sound is not super common in English, even still, because we didn't have a source like French bringing us a whole bunch of the words the way French brought us a bunch of V words. And so it's found in some words, but a lot of them, you can still sort of tell which one it's going to be based on context.
These two sounds are not particularly common across the world's languages, but the most prevalent fricative, in fact, one of the most prevalent sounds that you'll find across different languages of the world is, once again, moving a little bit further back in our mouths, the sound S.
Yes, the glorious S.
Satisfyingly common.
Satisfyingly sneaky, I was hoping you were going to say.
There is a high saturation of S. It's found in around 70% of the world's languages.
I have a fun story about the letter S versus the sound S.
Oh, yeah, that's always good to separate out the writing system and the sounds that are actually used.
It's really messed up. And the way that I know this is because when I was an undergraduate linguistics student with time on my hands and other linguistics student friends with times on their hands, we made a Scrabble set with international phonetic alphabet tiles.
Ooh. So you make words, but instead of spelling them out, you pronounce them out using the international phonetic alphabet.
Exactly. And it's kind of complicated because you can't just like take all the English alphabet letters and write their international phonetic alphabet version, because the distribution of tiles in a Scrabble set is like you have a lot of E's and you only have one Z and you only have one Q and stuff like this.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to figure out what's really common and what's really rare and decide both how many of them to put in the game and also what point value to give them.
Mm-hmm.
And this changes a lot of things. And by the way, I do actually have one of the very first blog posts that I made on my blog was from like a couple years earlier, this list of IPA Scrabble frequencies. So there's like a, you know, tiny spreadsheet you can download that has the frequencies and how you can make your own game if you want to get like cardboard and draw on it and then put it on your existing Scrabble set. You can totally do this, and some people have and sent me photos, which is amazing. So I will link to how to do this for yourself if this is a thing you need in your life now. But playing IPA Scrabble is also a super interesting experience, because almost the thing that was weird about it was not just what letters are surprisingly hard and they're rare. So that's how I learned that it's really hard to play like the in, you know, IPA Scrabble, because it's really high value letter that isn't found in a ton of words. But also, letters that you would expect would be easy are sometimes actually surprisingly hard. And one of those is S.
Okay, because our letter S doesn't always represent us saying the sound S.
Exactly. So the like letter S in the English orthography, but sometimes it's combined with like an H, but that makes a sh sound, and that's a different tile in IPA Scrabble.
Mm.
You have a sh tile and you have a s tile. So this is in words like C, okay, there's your S making an S sound, but then in she, you'd spell this in IPA Scrabble as a sh plus an E.
Because in English, we use sh to represent that sh sound.
Right. So there's a source of S's that you can no longer play.
Oh, there's so many sh words.
Right. And sometimes, like, an S makes a sh sound, and you don't even have an H there. So a word like sure, again, sir, well, that's a word in English, actually, but it's a different word.
You would have to have a very specific English accent to say I am sure.
Right. I mean, maybe there's an English accent that does this. And the way we played IPA Scrabble for the rules, because obviously, like, it's hard to have like an authority that's in charge of how anyone says it, is you had to pronounce it the way you were spelling it as you put it on the board.
Okay.
And so if you pronounced it differently from what you were putting on the board, it was like, I don't think this word spells what you think it spells.
Mm-hmm.
And that word had to be a valid pronunciation of the word in any dialect of English that anybody was aware of. And additionally, you have this other problem. So it's not just the sh problem with trying to play S in IPA Scrabble, which is a problem that I'm sure everyone finds completely relatable and common in your lives. But also you have a z problem, because there are actually a lot of words in English which are written with an S, but where it's pronounced like a z.
Oh my gosh, that's like half of English plurals, right? Because we use the S in writing to represent a plural. And it's one cat, two cats, so that's fine. But it's one dog, two dogs.
Exactly. And so this has the really interesting side effect that the Z tile in IPA Scrabble is suddenly really easy and low value to play.
Wow, yeah.
Because you could just use it to pluralize things.
Z is finally having its moment. It makes me really happy that this fricative is getting the attention that it deserves when you move away from writing.
But again, words like dogs, but also like wise, or something like analyze, which has, you know, two different spellings depending on whether you want to spell it with a Z or an S, but the S spelling is no longer legitimate if you're playing an IPA Scrabble, because it's actually pronounced with a Z both times.
And just a callback to moments ago, once again, a lot of those have arisen because S was between two vowels, and that turns on the voicing in your vocal cords.
Right. So you have words in English like house and house, which, again, it's a pair like breath and breathe, where even though they're both written the same way in modern day English, one of them's the noun and one of them's the verb, and you can hear that in how the fricatives change. You can also hear that because I have Canadian raising in the vowels. That's beside the point.
That's a whole other topic.
That's another episode someday. So S in English spelling can be sh, it can be z, and can also be the sound that's like the combination of those two things, which is the furthest from S, which is z.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a word like measure or Asia, or leisure.
Mm.
Here you have an S in the writing system that for various historical reasons has acquired both the z attribute of being between two vowels, your vocal cords are now doing a thing, and also the sh attribute of another context in the word being before a y sound often, where it's become more like the y. And it's gotten both of those things, and so you have like measure and leisure and Asia. And let me tell you, this is the highest value and most difficult card to play in IPA Scrabble is the zh sound, because it mostly shows up in English in either words that we've borrowed from other languages, like genre or rouge or zhuzh, or words that have multiple syllables where it's kind of arrived there for historical phonological reasons, like measure and leisure, which at one point was mesher or messier, and gradually got smushed together more and into a zh sound.
I love how deeply uncomfortable that sounded for you to say.
It's so difficult. Messier. Messier. Sounds like I'm saying messier, which probably if you say it fast is just like measure.
It's just such an embedded part of the way English works to make these changes in the middle of words.
Right. And so, like, zh, the IPA character tile, becomes really difficult to play because it's found in this fairly limited context, but it is in English, and so you have to put it in your IPA Scrabble set. And mm-hmm. s, which is often used to spell this whole set of words, suddenly actually gets a little bit more difficult to play, even though it's still found in, like, lots of words, like see and sit and tons of nice, short, Scrabble-ish words. But it's a bit harder than it used to be.
And as a literate English speaker, I imagine there's a lot of just trying to undo what your brain perceives as writing and listening to the actual sounds that are happening.
Right. And it gives you a ton of compassion for, like, children learning how to read and write, where they have to be told, like, no, I know we told you that, like, S makes the S sound, except in, like, all of these words, mm-hmm. where it can make four other sounds.
Shall we visit a fricative that's not in English?
Yeah.
There are many, and there are many ways that fricatives get used that English do not use them. So it's always lovely to hear about other people's language speaking and language learning experiences with these. But let's visit Wales.
Okay.
And we'll visit Welsh.
Okay, let's go to Wales. Staying on the British Isles, but with a Celtic language.
Welsh has a sound l, like in English, but they also have a sound that's made at exactly the same place in the mouth, but instead of going l, you just, well, first of all, you turn off the vibrations in your vocal folds, and then you make it like a fricative. And so it's written with a double L. So a name like Llewellyn in Welsh would be Llewellyn.
And the fun thing is, so I know a Welsh person who produces very nice hlas. And at one point I made some sort of joke about, so do you know the clothing chain known as LL Bean? They make like sweaters and stuff. I don't know if
I feel like it's a thing I have not encountered but have heard of.
I don't know if I've been to any in Canada, but like they're a thing I'm vaguely aware of. And I was like, oh, so does this mean that, you know, you pronounce LL Bean as if it's Welsh? And they actually had to pause and be like, wait. I've always in my head just been pronouncing this store as Hlabeen.
Oh no, really? Amazing.
And every time now, I just, you know, if you're ever having a bad day, you can just go Hlabeen.
Hlabeen. That is charming.
You know, and there's, isn't there a musician, LL Cool J, which I don't think my friend had heard of?
No, I think you mean Hla Cool J.
exactly. and so I made this joke with my friend's permission on Twitter, and somebody responded, well, you know, that's what happens when you talk to intellectuals.
I will never look at a double L in English the same way ever again. Thank you so much, Gretchen.
Thank my Welsh friend who prefers to remain anonymous, but whose permission mm-hmm. I did get to share this story. Mm-hmm. It's a fun sound. It's not only found in Welsh, but it is definitely one of the distinctive sounds in Welsh. It's just a really delightful fricative.
Been a nice holiday.
Shall we head over to the European continent?
Sounds great. Another lovely fricative, which is, we've just been moving further and further back in the mouth as we make these. And so now we're at h.
Yeah, and h is fairly interesting because there's a couple sounds there. There's the sound that's produced with your tongue in the same position as you would use to make a K, so h. And then there's a sound that's a tiny bit further back that has the vibration of the uvula, which is like the part in your throat that like dangles down and vibrates when you scream in a cartoon.
Mm-hmm. That's officially how it's described, yes.
You know, the screaming cartoon child mouth one. That's mm-hmm. the technical definition.
Yeah.
H h, which is a little bit further back in the throat. And some languages will just sort of treat both of those sounds as variations on the same sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Some languages will sort of have one or the other. It's probably some language that has both and differentiates between them as well. But there's sort of both things going on there. And a lot of the languages on the European continent have this h sound, especially the one that's a little bit further forward in the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, we didn't need to leave the British Isles because Scots and Scottish English has h sound as in loch.
Mm.
But also you see it in German, the classic sort of German Bach example that gets cited in the language textbooks. And one that doesn't get cited but is also still the same sound is the sound that J spells in Spanish as in jalapeño.
Jalapeño. Oh, that's a fricative.
That's a fricative, and it's the same fricative that's in the same position as a K,
mm-hmm.
which gets written as X in the International Phonetic Alphabet. And sometimes people think of that sound as sort of a variant on H, whereas they think of the German or the Scottish sound as a variant on K. But they're actually both the same sound if you look at how people actually produce them.
That's so interesting, and it ties into another area of phonetics. So we've been talking a lot about the way we produce sounds. But there's also really interesting that things that happen when we look at how people perceive specific sounds in the International Phonetic Alphabet and how that differs depending on the language that's being spoken or the people who are doing the speaking.
Yeah, and like the sound that's represented with an X, the H sound, it shows up in a lot of ideas that people have about languages. I think it's really leftover World War II propaganda, honestly.
Right.
Because German gets stereotyped as like, oh, it's got this sound, it's very hard in the back of the throat. But like, also this sound is in Dutch and Spanish, and people aren't saying this, like, oh, it's so harsh about Dutch, because they were our allies in the Second World War.
Hmm.
Dutch actually has more of them, because Dutch has this K-like sound that's where your vocal cords aren't vibrating, but it also has a G-like sound where your vocal cords are vibrating. I don't know if I can do it well. But like, if anything, Dutch has more of these, and yet no one is saying this about the Dutch.
And that's what I always find really interesting about the values that we attach to these sounds that are produced similarly. It's just the context that they're produced in really varies our attitudes towards them.
Right. And like, you know, Arabic has some of these sounds that are in the back of the throat, the H sound as well as a few others. But like, also so does French. And people aren't saying that French sounds, you know, harsh and guttural in the same sorts of ways. So, like, I hate the word guttural as applied to a language. It doesn't have a linguistically defined meaning. It generally just means, like, I'm going to be kind of racist now.
Yeah. I should say I specifically find the way people ascribe values interesting. I find the types of values that get ascribed very tedious. And learning about how sounds work mechanistically in the International Phonetic Alphabet is a really good way to start trying to step back from those knee-jerk reactions you have.
Right, exactly. The other fun fact about the fricative that's in this sort of, you know, CKG position is that it's sort of a ghost sound in English.
Okay, because of the, like, loch situation in Scottish English?
Not only that, but this is actually the sound that in English used to be represented with the sequence GH.
Mm-hmm.
So this is in words like night or laugh or enough or also a certain person's surname who you may have met.
Oh, yeah. Your surname, Gretchen McCulloch.
Thank you. So sometimes it represents GH. There are other people who have the O-U-G-H spelling of my surname. Not mine is spelled O-C-H. Because in modern English, it often gets approximated with C-H or maybe K-H. But historically in English, it was written with G-H. And this is why you sort of get G-H making all of these different sounds in English. Because in words like laugh and cough, it got made into a different fricative.
Mm-hmm.
So loch and koch became laugh and cough.
And your name became McCulloch.
You know, if only I could have been McCulloch.
So that didn't happen. So it went through other paths as well.
Right. And then sometimes it just went to zero. So you have like through and though and night and light. And that just like became silent and maybe affected the sound of the vowel next to it. And then in some cases it became like a K, like in the way I say my name, McCulloch, or in sort of modern day anglicizations of Loch or Bach, which is how you get a lot of English speakers saying those words if they're not super comfortable with that particular fricative. They'll pick the stop that's in the same position, the K. So it's this very interesting sort of, ooh, here's this ghost that was there in English and it still left its ghostly footprints in various parts of the language.
Left its little traces.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Except, incidentally, for the word ghost, which was never actually pronounced like that, and the H got added, I think, because of some early printers.
We are big fans of printing as a technology. We haven't got a lot of happy things to say about it in this episode, but I don't want to drive that point home too hard. While we are talking about ghosts, shall we finish our tour on H? Huh.
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 Yeah, there are other fricatives, especially, you know, in between huh and huh.
Various places we've visited.
But huh is H or H, depending on which variety of English you speak. I honestly think H is more logical. I just didn't grow up with it because it actually has the same of the sound in it. And this one is interesting in English because it's also super hard to play in IPA Scrabble.
Because words that we think have H in them often don't pronounce the H.
Right. So first of all, sometimes H is silent. And also, H is sometimes used kind of like a modifier character for other sounds.
Yes.
So you use it sometimes to modify vowels like ah and ooh and oh. You might write those with an H to express it like, yeah, I'm just trying to write this vowel. Here's this H that I've tacked on. And you also use it as a modifier character for consonants. So you can have like TH and SH, like we've already talked about. You can have CH. And all of this stuff you can no longer do if you're playing IPA Scrabble. You can't use it as a modifier.
Mm-hmm.
And what that means is that you also can't play it at the end of a word.
Yes, it only turns up at the start of words, really, if it turns up at all in English.
Right, and occasionally in the middle, so you get words like ahead.
True. I got ahead of myself there.
But you don't see it at the end of a syllable, which means you don't see it at the end of the word, so it means you're trying to make this sort of like branching Scrabble-style combination of words. Once you see an H, you've created a sort of dead end for yourself if you can't then attach the end of a word onto it.
Mm-hmm.
And this isn't true in other languages.
Oh yeah, that's true. That is pretty much exactly the reason that we have names like Sarah and Hannah that are often spelt with a H. They don't have to be because those sounds aren't pronounced in English, those H's at the end of the words. But I think it's because names like that are often borrowed from Hebrew, where those final H's are pronounced. We retained the spelling convention without retaining the pronunciation.
Right. When I was studying Arabic, there are totally still words in Arabic that have a final H that can be pronounced. And so you could say Hannah or Sarah, which might be a way to say it in another language, but is not how they're conventionally said in English.
Mm-hmm.
Because even producing that H at the end of a word can be a challenge for English speakers, or hearing it can be a challenge for English speakers.
It's possibly not that surprising that we don't have H at the end of words. And in fact, even at the start of words, we don't pronounce it a lot, even if it might have been there historically in words like hour.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we say an hour, because we treat it as though it starts with a vowel, and why North Americans often say herbs instead of herbs. And it's an easy sound to misplace because there's not a whole lot going on. As a fricative, it's not the most fricative of fricatives. There's not a lot of frication happening there.
Yeah, and H is interesting because it's actually produced with the vocal cords themselves constricting to make a fricative. So the only thing that you're doing is with your vocal cords. There aren't a lot of nerve endings in the vocal cords, so I'm always like, I'm doing this and I can make it because I'm thinking of the sound, but I don't feel like I'm actually feeling it because your vocal cords don't have a lot of nerve endings. I think they would sort of, it would actually like drive you up the wall to be feeling this constant like clash in your throat every single time you were engaging them in the middle of a word. It's probably good they don't have a lot of nerve endings, but I feel like unlike your lips, mm-hmm. where you can just sort of put them in a spot and feel them there, the further you go back in the throat, the further you start feeling what you're doing with being there.
When we were researching this episode, we actually looked at the International Phonetic Alphabet from a a bunch of versions of it because the International Phonetic Association regularly meet and assess the state of research and update the International Phonetic Alphabet. And H has been on this little journey where, like, in 2005, her shared a row with the fricatives, who we've met a bunch of, but also with sounds like ye and wu that are less about fricatives.
Yeah, so ye and wu have a bit of a bigger, still have a little bit of constriction in the mouth, but they have a bit of a bigger opening and a little bit less friction. So I can kind of see how somebody could say, like, well, maybe, what if we treated H, you know, sometimes it seems to show up like the ye or wu and has a bit less friction. But then they sort of restored it to only being a fricative box, possibly because it's confusing to have one symbol occupy two boxes, because they don't really do that very much elsewhere in the IPA.
Yeah, so it's been on this little journey. It is currently a fully fledged fricative, but it has been on an interesting little journey. And I think it's because there's less movement happening throughout the vocal tract while you're saying it.
Yeah, and it's also sort of a bit harder to see it and feel what's going on. Fricatives have a special spot for me because they were one of the first things that I learned about when I was in high school and I was sort of teaching myself linguistics and I was trying to get, you know, access to books and stuff. And I remember sitting down and being like, okay, here's this description of, like, there are actually words that describe all the different things that your mouth is doing when you're making all these different sounds. And you can describe what places is undergoing the constriction. And you can describe, like, how much constriction you're doing. And you have this, you know, thing in the vocal cords. And, like, all of these sorts of combinations. And I remember when I was, you know, probably about 15, and I was trying to just sort of wrap my head around this whole process. Mm-hmm. I was on a car trip with my mom, and I was explaining to her, like, here's what's going on in your mouth, and here's what this is, and here's what this is. And she was, you know, listening very appreciatively, as parents sometimes do.
I had a bit of a captive audience on a car trip.
You have a captive audience on a car trip, and I was like, here's the thing. And ever since then, I think she retained that bit, and she especially retained the word fricative, because she just really liked the sound of the word fricative, and
it's
she's like...
It's a fun word to say.
Well, she's like, it sounds like a swear word. You could just be like, fricative! I don't want to do this! And every so often she would sort of, like, when I kept doing linguistics in university, she'd be like, and, like, how are the fricatives doing? And, like, what's going on with the fricatives now?
Bless.
So I feel like our new fricative-themed merch is somewhat inspired by my mom's absolute delight in the word fricative.
We thought we'd take some inspiration from Gretchen's mum, who found it mildly expletive in its energy. And so whether you say it in surprise or joy or frustration, we have made a range of What the Fricative merch for you.
Yes, so you can put What the Fricative on a mug or a t-shirt, a notebook, various other items, and, you know, make people think, is this person swearing? And then you have an excuse to tell them some linguistics.
You can share your favorite fricative story with people who appreciate your merch or on social media. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcast, Google Podcast, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get Kiki Booba Skunks, What the Fricative t-shirts, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I tweet and blog as Superlinguo.
I can be found as @GretchenAMixie on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 53 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans, and you can even sponsor your favorite fricative or other International Phonetic Alphabet symbol on our Patreon IPA Wall of Fame. Recent bonus topics include the linguistics of Pokemon names, back-channeling, and speaking under the influence of various substances. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay, too. We also really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life.
Lingthusiasm is produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne. Our editorial producer is Sarah Doppiarella. Our managing producer is Liz McCullough. Our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!